historic First Hill in downtown Seattle. Tonight, KUOW, Seattle Radio Theater, Town Hall, and Elliott Great Book Company, and Mark Z. Danielewski present a special radio adaptation of Mr. Danielewski's novella, The 50-Year Sword. And now, here's Mark Z. Danielewski.
Maybe because the history of any ghost story is a ghost story unto itself, which is to say, another story completely, assuming any of what follows can rightly be considered a ghost story, rather than delve into the devices and biases and oddly canted idioms of five persons.
One of whom in the early years slept with another and now endlessly wonders about the legacy of thought.
Like someone else once wanted.
Two of whom still nurture their affection for one another, expressing so in an array of notes and overseas phone calls.
A fourth, who lost three.
And the last of whom, from the prison of a later life, hates them all.
Or represent them throughout with characterizing phrases, temporal references, and even more quotation marks hopelessly nested within reiterating nests of still more marks. To delineate their respective and independently conducted interviews, colored quotation marks are used instead.
Or voices.
Tonight, only voices. Where no voices sound, only the worst should be assumed. An interruption by someone other than one of the before-mentioned persons, the reader or even the author, who additionally, it must be stated, has done nothing more than lend together these gathered and re-related bits so as to here present a pretty peculiar and perhaps altogether alternate history of
one October evening in East Texas.
No matter how you cut it, no matter.
Gintana near didn't accept.
Only at the last moment, for reasons vague.
If vaguely professional.
Did she force from herself a reply in the affirmative, obviously, to
accept?
Yes, accept. The invitation.
Mose Devadown's invitation.
Fact is, what Gintana had discovered since the divorce was the most everything required.
Force.
Opening her eyes, her hands, even opening her medicine cabinet.
Forced.
Force open the can of bitter tea leaves, force back the tough tongues of those walking shoes she kept perched.
By a birdcage.
Force even a smirk she hoped could serve, temporarily at least, as a not-so-scored and heart-hunted a smile.
Especially when in the acknowledgement of something she recognized as social duty, she was forced to acknowledge.
Yet again.
To yet another intrusive customer, her husband Pravat's surprising departure.
Pravat. Force back something else, too.
Mustn't forget that.
The terrible agony she wished day out and night in to lash across the